Have you ever wondered what the church teaches about money and the accumulation of wealth? Well, stay tuned for this episode of Seek and Find and find out. Did you know that many of our modern banking practices trace their origin back to the Catholic Church? The first mortgages were written by monasteries so that poor peasant farmers could purchase for themselves their own piece of farmland. Letters of credit were written by the Knights Templar so that pilgrims to the Holy Land could take themselves from Europe all the way to Jerusalem without having to carry their wealth with them, which would make them susceptible to bandits or robbers. And finally, the Franciscan friar Luca Pacioli, who was the father of modern accounting, was the first to codify double-entry bookkeeping so that monasteries and other houses of religious could better account for all the wealth that they had inherited. So now we've seen that the church has quite the history with the banking world. But what does it actually teach about individual wealth? We might look at the scriptures and see the story of Jesus with the rich young man, where he tells him to go sell all he has and give it to the poor and follow him. However, this story we think is more of an instance of Christ looking into the individual heart of this man and seeing what is holding him back from God, not a general condemnation of wealth. We also can see the story in Acts of the Apostles of the early apostolic community. They all lived in a community, giving all their wealth to the apostles to be distributed evenly. And while this is true, and many members of the community were punished because they did not give all that they have, they were punished for lying to the apostles, not for holding back their wealth. And it's also seen that all the other communities founded by the apostles and by St. Paul as well, none of them lived in the same manner. The Catholic Church has always taught that private property is a good thing. The Catechism of the Catholic Church says that private property is a guarantor of human freedom and human dignity. The bishops of Vatican II in Gaudium et Spes describe private property as the best way to ensure the autonomy of the individual person and the human family. And Pope Leo XIII in 1891, in the middle of the Industrial Revolution, proclaimed in Rerum Novarum that private property was the best way to ensure human flourishing, and that it was a right given by God through nature. And that was affirmed both by Pope Pius XI 40 years later and Saint Pope John Paul II 100 years later. And we can look even in Scripture in all the way back in the Old Testament, the Ten Commandments, the seventh commandment, thou shalt not steal, and the tenth commandment, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's goods, assume that there is a certain right to private property. But we cannot take it to extreme and become hoarders of all goods. Jesus warns us of this with the parable of the man who builds a barn and fills it with grain, but dies that night. In the book of Job, Job says very well, naked I came forth, naked I will go back. In fact, or more simply, as we might say, you can't take it with you. Private property is a gift from God that is to be used for the benefit of our brothers and sisters. If we continue to look in the scriptures, specifically in the New Testament, we see many instances where private property, the wealth of individuals, is used for the good. Our Lord and Savior himself was buried in the tomb of the wealthy Joseph of Arimathea. St. Paul frequently talks about in his letters, and St. Luke in the Acts of the Apostles, the many people who contributed to his ministry throughout the Mediterranean region, including many women like Lydia and Phoebe and Priscilla. Throughout the history of the church, 2,000 years, the church has depended on wealthy individuals to help it in spreading their gospel message. In a previous episode of Seek and Find, we heard from Father Patrick, who talked about mendicant friars. Their whole existence is dependent on the charity and wealth of others to provide their ministry of spreading the gospel message to the world. Think of the many beautiful churches and cathedrals throughout the world, the beautiful pieces of art and music that have been funded by the generosity of the Christian faithful. The church you're sitting in every Sunday was only made possible because members of your parish at some point in time got together and paid for the building of a new church. This church, St. Luke's here in Barrington, Rhode Island, was renovated 20 years ago. And those renovations were made possible by members of our parish who got together and donated money in order, in memory of their friends and family members, that they may have a beautiful place to worship God. The generosity of the Christian faithful had provided for the social services that are provided by the church for the poor, the hungry, and the homeless. And it doesn't always require a direct donation to the poor or the homeless. One of the best ways, actually, that we can provide for people is by investing in opportunities that create jobs that can actually help people out of their poverty. Pope Pius XI, who I mentioned earlier, said that is actually one of the best ways to tackle poverty. We must remember that wealth is not a zero-sum game. It's not a static pie that we have to carve up. Wealth is constantly growing. It's constantly being made greater. And the Christians, there are some Catholic Christians who have an obligation to participate in that process so that they may use that wealth to provide for the good of their brothers and sisters. We must also remember that how we build up our wealth is just as important as what we do with it. Any action that would take advantage, unjust advantage, of one of our brothers and sisters, or any action that abuses the wonderful gift of nature that God has given us, would be unacceptable. Building up wealth gives us the opportunity to be charitable with our brothers and sisters. It might seem easier if we could just give our excess wealth to a central authority, say the government or a church, and let them take care of the poor and homeless and the hungry. But that would rob us of our opportunities to express our love for our brothers and sisters. But on the same side, the government has a moral obligation to provide for the lowest among us, and to do so through a fair and equitable tax system. However, the tax can never be so high that we believe that the poor are already taken care of, or that they take so much from us that we have nothing left to give the poor ourselves. As far as what that tax is and what other means the government can use to take care of the poor and the homeless and the hungry, it's something that we as Catholics are allowed to debate to a certain extent. As long as our debate comes out of a desire to serve the poor and a detachment from our wealth, and not one of greed and selfishness. My name is Father Brian Morris, and this has been Seek and Find.